morning, everybody. I hope you can all hear me. I'm very pleased and honored to be able to open this first panel in the first conference of the SSM. And the title of this panel is The New Supervisory Structure 1 year on. So unlike the other two panels, which are more outward oriented, more looking to the outer world of financial stability and financial reform, this one is particularly focused on looking at the SSM. And so the idea is to use this opportunity and the high level of the speakers that we have to do a little bit of reflection, maybe an assessment on the achievements, on the state of play, and also the areas of progress, perhaps of improvement, that we can identify in the SSM. Now, in the exchanges that we've had among the panelists before today and in preparation for today, we have often made reference to the concept of the notion of SWOT. This is the planning tool that is used to assess and to analyze the performance of projects and structures, et cetera. SWOT means strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threats. And so you may not be surprised that maybe some of the speakers will refer to this structure in presenting their views. So to do that, we have chosen four persons that are not only outstanding, each in himself, but also occupy a particular position and have a particular point of view relative to the SSM. So let me introduce the speakers. On my far right, Matthias de Vatripont, who, in addition to being a long-standing and outstanding academic, as we will hear today, his contribution with Jean Tirole are well known. He's also an active supervisor in the National Bank of Belgium and a member of the supervisory board. So he presents a little bit the insider view, not inside in the ECB proper, but inside in the mechanism, in the structure. And so Matthias will go first. Then we have on my right Gunther Dunkel in his dual capacity as CEO of Nortel Bank, which is a very important Landesbank in Germany, and also president of the German Association of Public Banks. So he presents the view of the supervised entities of the SSM and in particular of a very important component of our banking sector, that of the German public banks. On my immediate left, Roberto Gualtieri, who is the chair of ECON. ECON is the Economic and Monetary Committee of the European Parliament. And so as such, he's a little bit the controller, the addressee, one of the addressees of our accountability, a very important addressee of our accountability. I want to recall the key role that the European Parliament has played in the construction of the SSM. When the SSM regulation was written, there was an intense dialogue and many contributions came precisely from the European Parliament before Roberto was there. There is an agreement between the SSM, ECB, and the European Parliament for the exchange of information and for the modalities of accountability. So the European Parliament is a very important component, I would say, of the SSM structure broadly intended. Last but not least, on my far left, André Sapir. He's a professor at ULB and a senior fellow at Bruegel. Very well-known expert on many things, including financial markets and banking, etc. So I think he represents the community of observers, of judges, of watchers of what we do. And as such, I think his contribution is going to be very important. So the plan is to have a first round, as usual, of interventions of about 12 minutes or so, starting with Matthias and going around like this, then maybe quick rejoinders, and we hope to have some time at the end to reach out to the audience to have some comments and questions, and then finally a discussion among us. So I would like to ask Matthias to intervene first.
Well, thank you, Ignazio. Thanks a lot for this invitation to speak. I feel honored, just like I felt honored from day one to be able to participate in this very, very impressive project, which is the Banking Union. First, as a member of this so-called high-level group that was presided by Mario Draghi, and where Ignazio played a very, very influential role. And I think this project is quite exciting indeed. As Ignazio said, he suggested that we evaluate it through this SWOT analysis, and so here are the sentences I chose, and I will go one by one, so you don't need to memorize them at this point. Let me start with the strength. Robust risk-based supervision built on a new European institution. I think, Daniel said it very well, Mario also, this is really a key new institution in the European landscape, with extremely impressive achievements since the beginning of 2014 and even earlier. 2014 was really amazing. One had to do this comprehensive assessment while at the same time building up the institution. I remember Daniel telling me once, when I arrived here in Frankfurt in January 2014, I was the first employee of the SSM, and then it had to be built up. And while at the same time conducting together with the national competent authorities the comprehensive assessment. Now, she rightly said that the support of the ECB has been really tremendous. But on the other hand, it was also very important to start hiring SSM people and have them work very, very hard. By the way, in the NCAs, there was also a lot of hard work, but we were joking, of course, often, that during 2014, here in the SSM, they were not working 9 to 5, but 5 to 9. Frankly, it was really very, very important. And I do think that indeed the comprehensive assessment was a game changer. I think everybody agrees with that. Interestingly, this year, there is this other comprehensive assessment for Greek banks. And on the one hand, I think it's completely obvious to everybody that it is the SSM that has to do it. And I think that shows how established all this is. Now, a somewhat more worrisome thing is that when you see the speed at which the situation can change, the environment can change, because the Greek banks were part of the earlier comprehensive assessment, and they were okay. But of course, with what has happened in the first semester of Greece, things have changed a lot. By the way, this was not, there are at times banks creating problems for their country, and at times the country create problems for the banks. Here is the second, obviously. And so when you see all these non-performing loans and all that, it is creating a problem of the order of 10 to 25 billion euros being refined. So I think this is scary. We should always remember banking is quite can be quite fragile, even if even in the cases where it's not the banks doing crazy things. But I do think that clearly the SSM has done a lot this year, and that was under the supervision of Ignazio again. This progress on harmonization of option and national discretion has been quite important. And then the other thing, it's the assessment of banks, Pillar 2, or the SREP methodology, which now, this year, is the first year of a real convergence beyond the comprehensive assessment. And I think that's, one of the flagship programs of the SSM this year. And you see clearly the benefit there of benchmarking across countries, across business models. We are really moving towards this, as Daniel said, the tough but fair supervision. And I do think a lot of progress has already been done. It's still unfinished business, as was said, but I do think it's quite impressive. So that's for the strength part. What did I choose as weakness? I think, let's face it, Europe is not simple. Now, you can say that, okay, nation building in peacetime is clumsy. Let's face it, it beats the other ways to do it. So this is the way to go. But let's face it, this is quite a complex process. I think Mario Draghi stressed the limits of existing treaty. There are things we can do, things we cannot do. Delegation is at times difficult. There is a question at some level of legal risk appetite, but let's face it, we don't have always the best text around, but of course we cannot go back to the voters and ask for the text to be changed because they might say no. There is still multiplicity of national laws, some of them for good reasons, some for less good reasons. So I do think this is something which necessitates a lot of work that might be better used for other things. But this is a challenge that is being addressed. Maybe one area to watch in particular, I think, is macroprudential policies, where, frankly, the complexity is enhanced by the multiplicity of actors at both national and Eurozone levels. Let's face it, our monetary union is not fully perfect. We do have, once in a while, asymmetric shocks. So it is important that there is a national component of macroprudential policy as a complement to the only interest rate we have in the Eurozone. So I think a clever idea was put forward about a shared competence where both the national and the Eurozone level can become stricter. But this leads to some complex procedures. Moreover, even more important, I think, the definition of macroprudential policy has not stabilized yet. We have quite a big toolbox, bigger and bigger toolbox, with not only capital requirements, general aggregate and also sectoral, but also loan-to-value limits, debt service to income limit and all that, and different actors being in charge of these kinds of things, which are often politically sensitive. So I think this is an area where we should try and make sure to streamline the processes as possible, as much as possible, because these things will be important, especially in the context of the Eurozone. On opportunity, I think this is connected to the unfinished business part of this, as I will say in the end. The glass is definitely more than half full, but it's not fully full. Since 2014, the SSM has added more than 1,000 supervisors here in Frankfurt to the 5,000 supervisors that are still there and very useful and relevant in the national competent authorities. So in the short run, let's face it, it was not always easy to coordinate everybody and to make sure that everybody could fit in the new organization. But a lot has been achieved. But I do think that more can be done to really make sure that we can really use all the available information, because that's a big benefit of the banking union, is that we now have much more opportunities to compare. And there, let me distinguish two different dimensions. First, these joint supervisory teams, which is in a sense the cornerstone of the new banking union. So teams coordinated by somebody here in Frankfurt with people working here in Frankfurt and in the NCAs. Frankly, I think the learning has been quite quick there. And you do hear a lot of people saying that, this is now working better and better. And as a member of the supervisory board, what we can see in terms of the types of cases that we discuss, frankly, it's more and more impressive the kind of information we are having and the reports that we are receiving about what is being done. At the transversal level, in terms of making comparisons, I think there is still more room for further improvement to fully exploit the available resources. That's partly because, in a sense, in the beginning, all the attention was focused on these GSTs. How do we make sure the micro-prudential supervision can really work as well as possible. But you know, we have all this information that we can use to make comparisons. And one idea maybe is to build synergies between the micro and the macro prudential analysis, because at the NCA level, we do have a fair amount of information across our own country. And often the relevant market for retail banking is the country. And I do think, frankly, there maybe making connections between the transversal analysis in the SSM and the national analysis could be helpful. Finally, the threat. The threats I chose was maybe not coming from within, but more from outside. Let's face it, for now, decades, maybe centuries, we have been trying to make a balance between safe and sound banking, a banking system that supports the real economy, which, by the way, often says less capital, while the first says more capital, and no use of taxpayer money, which, of course, very important now. In theory, these are not incompatible. At times, it's hard to achieve them simultaneously. We all know the 2007-2008 crisis, but you know, the savings and loan crisis in the US in the 80s was about the fact that we didn't want to use taxpayer money, so we pretended the problem was not there, and then banks made stupid things, and then in the end, it cost a lot more money. Japan in the 90s, a very good example also, where you didn't want to use taxpayer money, you pretended things were okay, and it was a disaster in terms of forbearance and growth. So I do think today we do see that the objectives of banking, financial stability, safe and sound banking, seem to be competed away a bit by this idea, no taxpayer money, and this idea, jobs and growth. I don't want to criticize the commissioner, but I guess the second, the problem here, for example, BRRD saying, look, no taxpayer money, 8% bail-in of balance sheet and all that. Frankly, this could at times be dangerous if you start threatening short-term deposits. And by the way, this is one example why in Greece today we are trying to do everything in 2015 before BRRD enters into full force. So I do think that is something we should keep in mind. The second, you know, we all love SMEs. There was probably overshooting in securitization. However, if all these initiatives mean less capital for banks, let's face it, this is possibly a risk. And in the end, who will bear the risk? Well, the supervisor. Because frankly, as I say here, supervision can only be as robust as regulation allows. But often the supervisor is blamed ex post. And let me just conclude here. First of all, to stress again that the glass is much more than half full, and this for a huge task. So I think many congratulations to the SSM. But let me quote Charles Goodhart, who talked at the 25th anniversary of Basel I. And I remember you said, Charles, talking to us supervisors, the supervisor's job is, in a sense, the hardest in the world. Most of your successes remain private, while your failures become very much public. And I think it's true. And so I do think supervisors do need support from the environment at large, from regulators, from politicians, and I think it's very important. It's a bit self-serving, but I think it's important. Thank you.
Thank you, Matthias, for this, your last very encouraging remark. And now I give the floor to Gunther Dunkel.
Thank you very much. Good morning to everybody. It's a true honor also to speak here, because I have to commend to your risk-taking, Mr. Angeloni, to invite such a banker here to this distinguished group. You don't know what I'm going to say as one of the supervised victims, so to speak. And by the way, the last remark also holds partly for the bankers, because I feel something like that as well. And I think one has to start out with, and I will not skip to the model here, one has to start out with commending the ECB for its achievements, but I think we should not revel too much in it. Just one observation: sometimes the ECB feels a little bit like a startup. Not all the processes are there, not everybody knows what wants to do, and also one sees from the outside, I have the feeling that the euphoria, we are going to change everything, is clearly over. So a lot of realism has come in, and I think that's frankly a very good thing. I can commend the ECB for setting up the JSTs. From my observation, I think the cooperation between the JSTs and the banks works quite well as it can work, because the circumstances are, of course, difficult. So let's get over with all the good part, because we are all Germans, and I'm Northern German, although I'm part Austrian. So as a Northern German, we are quick with what's good, and then we go into what can be improved or what can be better. And pardon me for being perhaps not as diplomatic, as polite as I should be, as in these circles usually it is. I'm speaking more bluntly as a banker. The first criticism, I want to say it, that it's very unclear sometimes for the banks how the ECB actually takes decision and how it arrives at its conclusion, especially in the SREP process. We know the result, we know the analysis, but we don't know how you get from A to B. And that is a problem in itself, but for the question, how can I improve? And frankly, that's the key question from every report I get as leading a bank. It is very hard to derive what you change if you don't know exactly how you arrived at it. Because when you know how you arrived at it, you know what you have to change. So that's the first risk. There's also a lot of unclarity what the final capital charges will be, because the system has become so complicated that if I get asked by my shareholders, what's your target capital rate? I have, of course, one. But I always have to make the caveat, I don't know finally. I have a SREP quota, but I have a complicated system which adds to it. And then I don't know. I have, of course, an idea where I think the bank should be there. But I think there could be an improvement putting much more clarity there. Second, I think data collection is a good thing. It helps us to improve the bank. But what is sometimes overlooked is that data collection costs a lot of money and effort. And of course, I have millions of ideas of what data I could select for my bank. But since I run a P&L, I have to be very careful where I do want to spend the money. And the second part is not always, and now I'm being polite, the first consideration the data gatherers think about when they create the question of what data could be useful. It should be the question what data is useful, very useful, essential, and is worth gathering within the banks. Because I can tell you, it not only costs a lot of pure money, it takes attention away from what we actually should do, and that is serving clients. And also in this room, this is what we are about. We are not about being safe, that's very important, but at the end of the day, we need to serve clients. And therefore, I urge the ECB to make up its mind, together with all the other supervisors, what do you want to know, and then keep that data set more stable so that I don't have to review basically on a quarterly basis my project portfolio of what I do have to do in succession to be able to fulfill the data sets which comes from basically everywhere. A remark on business models. I think it's a very, very good thing that we focus the supervision on business model. But it is not quite clear on which banking architecture the ECB, and actually I want to enlarge the picture, the whole supervisory architecture, at what banking architecture they are heading at. What kind of banks do we want in Europe? And if you want to have my interpretation of what is the ideal bank in the supervisory world in Europe, it is regional. We don't really like global banks. It is oriented towards SMEs, because that's what everybody is speaking of, not so much on global corporates. It's clearly oriented towards short-term exposure and not long-term project finance. It is clearly retail deposit funded. We like retail deposit funding, and it's clearly not trading-based. It needs very benign shareholders and not states as shareholders, and they should be happy with a return on equity of 5%. That is implicitly of what we are doing with the regulation at the moment. It does not work, because we need more than our ideal bank. And I urge, with all the questions on business model, and of course, if you would ask the ECB what's the ideal bank, they would answer, we are agnostic about it, we just need good banks. But implicitly, the whole regulatory body focuses in that direction, and I want to point that out in this of this experience of 1 year. And just as a side remark, we tend to forget about it, but I think also the internal conflict of interest between the two parts of the ECB, and pardon me to be so open about it, should not be forgotten. It is there. You clearly could see it when you talk about UniCredit. It was not the supervisory part who said we need more credit, knowledge and credit data. It was the macro side who did it. And there could be other areas as well. The question of charge for public credits is also clearly a thing where you can feel and understand that the conflict of interest is there. So in concluding, you also have, by that you have seen what could be improved. I think there is urgent need that the bodies, the supervisory bodies, aside the ECB, because if I would have really a single supervisor, I would be the happiest person on earth. I don't have it. I have 10, 11, 12, and they need to act together between them. So I urge you that the level of cooperation, not only within the ECB, which has pointed out, but also among the supervisory body, clearly has to be improved. There has to be much more coordination, in my view. I think we need still to improve about the transparency and clarity how to improve banks, not only what's the result, in my view. And of course, I support very much the level playing field and the question of, you know, that we should harmonize our European side. We have made steps, but clearly the more difficult steps, in my view, are still in front of us. With an apology for a very clear and perhaps sometimes unusual language here, but I think that's very important that we make some progress for the next year. I conclude my remarks. Thank you very much for listening so patiently to me.
Thank you very much, Herr Dunkel, for asking pointed questions to the SSM and also giving the answers. Roberto Gualtieri.
Thank you. It's been really a pleasure to be invited to attend this forum and to celebrate this first birthday of the ESSM, which I agree totally can be considered this first year quite successful. And as Ignazio Angeloni has reminded, the European Parliament has been since long time strongly supporting, advocating the necessity of this and the possibility of this leap forward. So the necessity of and possibility of complementing the single rule book with a single supervision, not only to enhance stability, confidence in our banking system, but also to create a real level playing field in banking market, to enhance financial integration, to foster risk sharing within the monetary union, and to contribute to break the link between sovereign and banks at national level. So indeed, I think we can objectively say that the ESSM has been a success, both on operational point of view and in terms of its supervisory quality, and that its added value is clearly evident already after 1 year. Of course, there are still margin of improvements and great challenges ahead. So I will try to say something about those elements, focusing on the operational progress on the one hand and on the supervisory policy on the other hand. But before doing that, I would like to underline that the accountability framework of the ESSM is an element of strength, which provides, I think, great legitimacy to its operation, and of course puts also a lot of responsibility to the European Parliament. And I can say that the exercise of democratic accountability by the ESSM has been very efficient, and I really welcome the ECB transparent attitude in this area. So first, of course, we, in the framework of this accountability framework, we will present a first annual report. I'm the rapporteur, so there I will be the possibility to have more detail. Here I will identify just some elements. On the, in the area of operational capacity, indeed, I think the successful launch of the SSM should be considered a remarkable achievement, especially if we consider the short time, the constraint, the really enormous difficulty of the effort. I will just list a number of elements that I consider remarkable that I think is worth recalling, because it's true, sometimes things that go well are considered obvious and one tends to focus more on problems. So I think that the recruitment process has been swift and is providing really a good blend of competences, cultures, gender, and this is really giving credibility to a supernatural nature of the SSM. We had the rapid drafting, building on national best practices on supervisory manual, and laying down common procedure methods for conducting the SREP. I will come back on that. And very efficient setup of the IT infrastructure and supporting analytical tool. A thorough and widespread training activity program for NCAs and ECB staff, composition of JST, and the dialogue that they establish with the credit institution. Also, of course, further improvement can be pursued, including by better involving NCAs in the day-to-day functioning of the JST and in the decision-making process, and the process devised to efficiently work off the common procedure, authorization of qualifying holdings, licensing, passporting, fit and proper assessment. Of course, it's clear that there is a significant share of work which is devoted to administrative procedures, and its importance not always seems commensurate to the effort required. So the Parliament is ready to consider proposals aimed at reducing the operational burden on structures at all levels, for instance, by delegating certain decisions on specific administrative issues within, of course, clear limit and guidelines. And we see also margin of improvements in the quality of interaction. Here, maybe the two key words are dialogue and predictability. We note that from the side of supervised entities, there is a request of better early planning, for instance, of supervisory activities as meeting. There is a request of more, let's say, feedback, and especially it has been reminded right now, the need of better, let's say, understanding the common supervisory approach, which is underlying the concrete individual microprudential measures. the solution can be many, more transparency, more dialogue, maybe some element of also direct interaction between DG4, the horizontal one, and the banks. On the other hand, we have to know that many of those problems are also physiological if we consider that at the same time banks are experiencing this huge leap forward, the phasing of Basel III, and overlapping with that also the discussion, very advanced discussion of other additional measures, both prudential and structural. So it's clear that this feeling of uncertainty as objective reason, but I think everybody should do its part in trying to addressing this problem. And then the area of supervisory policy. I agree totally that comprehensive assessment has been a game changer, a fundamental step in restoring confidence lost through the crisis years, in enhancing resilience of our banking system, both by improving capitalization and improving transparency. And also it's really important that now the current SREP can be based on a new full European methodology. Of course, we understand that this methodology has been finalized during the work, so it might benefit of further refinement, but it's clearly an important step forward. Of course, some problems I think are also the consequence of a not always clear provision of the legislation. We understand that currently there is a problem in identifying the better stacking, let's say, of a different buffers, pillars, and addressing the problem of the interaction with the maximum distributable amount is a problem because it's true, the legislation is not clear. But at the same time, I think this factor does not prevent the supervisor to use the appropriate degree of flexibility if one takes into account what other jurisdictions are doing, also within the same legal framework. So I don't want to give solution, it's not our job, but it's not explicitly forbidden that a Pillar 2 can be defined in different element or should be considered an element which triggers the MDA restriction, which are also very relevant for the 81 bond market. Another crucial aspect which we strongly support is the work that has been undertaken to enhance the quality and the comparability of capital and to properly measure the different forms of risks. So we strongly support the work on the homogenization of risk-weighted asset, which is pivotal for comparability purpose and on internal models for calculation of banks' capital requirements. I think further steps are at the same time necessary to reinforce the capacity of scrutiny of the bank financial activity in order to improve the capacity to look beyond credit risk to all forms of risk. And last but not least, there is the point, the issue of the option and national discretion, whose a problem left by problem produced by the legislature, and clearly this whose coordinator exercise may substantially endanger the effectiveness of the single supervision and also the banking union project. So we really strongly welcome and support the initiative and the intense work undertaken by the SSM on the revision of the OND. This is a clear example, I would say, of the complementarity between single rulebook and single supervision and of how a single supervision is a dynamic element that can foster further convergence of rules. So we look forward to the incoming consultation. We understand the decision has been taken and we expect the package that if on the one hand should of course be implemented with the necessary gradualism, on the other hand should be sufficiently ambitious and comprehensive and should address all pre-existing barriers and segmentation. This consideration about the unavoidable interaction between supervision and regulation leads me to the final remark, which is also connected to the remarks that I heard from other speakers about the need of strategic coherence, clarity, the trilemma between soundness, supporting economy, not taxpayer money. So this tells us that clearly we have to know, this is obvious, but it's important to fully understand that SSM is an integral part of the banking union, of the broader EMU and EU governance framework. And this means that to reach its goals and to be fully effective and successful, the single supervision requires, on the one hand, substantial steps in completing banking and economic union, and also in building a single market for capitals. And on the other hand, a success of the efforts for relaunching sustainable growth and promoting stability. So having stronger governance and better policies requires, on the one hand, clearly independence of different institutional actors, full respect of their different mandates, but it's also essential a collective capacity to ensure a certain degree of coherence, a common strategic orientation, a consistency and a coordination between, for instance, macroprudential and microprudential policies, as well as between economic and monetary policy, more in general, between stability and growth. Of course, the main responsibility for this falls into the EU legislative and executive branch, and the European Parliament stands ready to contribute with all the institutions, including the ECB and the SSM, to this indispensable collective endeavor. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much, Roberto Gualtieri, in particular for the constant expression of support that we receive from the European Parliament in what we are doing. André.
First of all, let me thank the organizers for the honor and the pleasure to be here today to celebrate this first birthday. It has been very interesting, I would say, as a watcher, to see the conception, the birth, and now indeed the 1 year of operation of this remarkable new and much needed institution. Now, contrary to many other leading central banks, the Riksbank in Sweden, the Bank of England, the Federal Reserve in the United States, the ECB was not created at a time to solve or to deal with a financial crisis. We had to wait until the financial crisis, 2007, 2008, and eventually the sovereign debt crisis and the reinforcement of the financial problems in Europe to see the ECB be granted powers over supervision. Now, as we were asked, I will make my assessment of the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats to the SSM against this background of the fact that the SSM has been newly created and was created at a special time. And that special time, although matters have changed, we are still in a sense in the midst of a difficult situation. Now, I think first to look at the strength, it's clear that in 1 year of operation, as many speakers have already indicated, the SSM has achieved a lot. It has kept its promise with the comprehensive assessment. I think a page has been turned. It's clear also that the people who are working in the SSM are highly committed, they are mission-oriented, and indeed, they were, as I said, the SSM was created for a mission, and I think there is that feeling when one talks to people, to the supervisors involved in the SSM, that they are part of this mission and that they are giving their best efforts and their best endeavor to deal with the issue at hand. So I think indeed, I think that's certainly a strength, what has been achieved and what is the quality and the orientation of the people who are working in the institution, the high caliber and the high quality of the people. Now, it's clear at the same time though we are not anymore in the crisis mode that we knew in 2012, in 2013, before the creation of the banking union, and yet we are not in a steady state. We are not out of the woods. We are certainly very much still in a transition period. We are still living through some of the wounds of the crisis. And I think there are two reasons, really, why we are still very much, after 1 year of operation, in a transition period. You know, the crisis not yet over, the intensity is maybe past, but many of the elements are still remaining. Now, I would say that there are still two reasons why we should consider the current position of the SSM to be one of transition. The first one is the one that has been indicated by Mario Draghi in his speech, that Mathias de Watripon emphasized, is the incompleteness of the banking union, sort of the governance. Okay, we know that indeed the European governance system in general is highly complex, and the banking union is certainly part of that. And we heard President Draghi emphasize very much the need to complete the banking union. We can't have the SSM out there without the support and the cooperation, which will be much needed, of now the new body, the single resolution mechanism, and hopefully soon a deposit insurance mechanism. One could also address something that is dear to Charles Goodhart, the notion of land of last resort. Do we need also to have the ECB function as the lender of last resort to those institutions, at least those that are directly supervised by the SSM? So I think there is the governance matter that needs to be completed, and rather sooner than later, certainly. But I think that there is a more substantive reason why the current period is still very much one of transition, why we are clearly still away from the steady state that we all hope, when supervision will become once again very boring. Now, the other reason, as I said, is the economic and financial situation, very simply. I think we are still in a difficult time, both on economic and on financial grounds. And I would say there are two issues here. One is the legacy problems. The legacy problems are still very much present, more in some countries certainly than in others. But when one looks at the euro area, one can see a lot of legacy problems, and I'll say a word on this in a second. And the other is the difficult macroeconomic environment with low growth and low inflation. Now, on the legacy issues, legacy is not just, and it's certainly very much, but not only the issue of the high debt levels that remain in some countries, private debts, public debts, different mixes in different countries, the non-performing loans that are there. But it's also the fact that has been alluded by several speakers, is the fact that as a result of the crisis, certainly regulatory requirements have been increased. And we are in a situation where we don't know exactly what is the business model of the banks that is expected by the regulators, by the supervisors. But even independently of that, the banking world is certainly in great flux for a variety of reasons, some that are related to the crisis and the regulatory supervisory environment that has been changing a great deal. But there are other factors, including the digital economy. So I would say that the banking sector in Europe, for a variety of reasons, including what we discussed when I was with Martin Helvig at the in the advisory scientific committee of the ESRB, the notion of overbanking. You know, one can discuss what it means exactly and different views, but one can see that the banking sector, as a result of all of those tensions, some external to the crisis and some directly related to the crisis, is going to undergo a great deal of changes. And the dust has not settled, certainly, and maybe we are at the beginning of some of those changes. So I think if you look at the legacy of the debt, the fact that the banking system is going to be in great flux, and then you add the macroeconomic environment of low growth and low inflation, and frankly, if you look at the next 5 years, you know, our central scenario would be low growth and low inflation. You know, though we all hope that we are going to obtain results on both fronts, on the front of inflation and on the front of growth, I think it would be safe to consider that as the environment. Now, I'm coming, obviously, as a result of that, now to the opportunities and threats for the SSM. It seems to me that the ECB is in a challenging posture. On the one hand, with its monetary policy tools, it has to fight low inflation. It has to help us improve the macroeconomic environment in a difficult global macroeconomic environment. It's not just a problem as we see in the Eurozone. The difficult macroeconomic environment of low inflation, of low growth, is something which is global today. So difficult, certainly, situations for, I would say, central banks in general, not just the ECB, but the central banks in general, to fight that low-inflation situation. And on the other hand, the ECB, as in its function of SSM, has to be dealing with this transformation of the banking system and the legacy problems. And the legacy problems that can be quite quite challenging, again, in different countries and with all the political implication that it has. So I would say that the great opportunity for the SSM in the coming year or coming years is to put some order in this situation, is to continue to make progress. Yes, there was the comprehensive assessment. Yes, there was now the situation about Greece. I would say it's a good start. But there's a lot more to be done, a lot of more challenges to be done, and that's a great opportunity for the supervisors and the quality supervisors that I discussed before to be able to do the job. The threat is that the weakness of the system, the weakness of the governance system in Europe will remain. And will remain that those problems of governance will not be solved in time for some of the challenging choices that the SSM will have to take, and that it may therefore pose real issues for the system. So let's hope that indeed it will be a year or years of opportunity rather than threats. But I would remind my my supervisory friends, and I think Matthias was very much on this line in his conclusion, that indeed one has to watch for the threats rather than for the opportunities. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, André and all the others. I have collected a large number of important points, and I want to mention them telegraphically because I don't think they should be lost before reaching out to the speakers and to the audience. Institutional complexity and legal complexity. This is a daily problem as we move on and we apply the rules to concrete cases to have a reliable, transparent, easy to administer framework, in particular to distinguish the national legal responsibilities and prerogatives from the European ones. We have some overarching rules,
when there is a clear conflict, European law prevails. And we have the transposition laws that we have to apply. But in a number of concrete cases, we need a better roadmap to understand where and how one prevails, the other one prevails, or the two interact. This is a very important point that I think was raised first by Matthias and then by others. Second, also a key element, the narrow path that the supervisor has to walk between stability and no bailout. No bailout exists in the European rule. It exists for sovereigns. It increasingly exists for banks. And yet we have a mandate of stability. And it's very critical, very complex to call a judgment in every concrete situation as we move on, particularly in our authority as supervisor, to be able to make the right choices between these two elements. A number of points by Herr Dunkel. I thank you very much for your frankness. I think that was exactly right to point to a number of problems. The first is transparency, the first that you mentioned, transparency of the SREP, transparency of the methodologies in general. People like me that are unfortunately old enough to have lived the transformation in central banking in the mid-1980s and 1990s remember that secrecy was one of the hallmarks of central bankings at the time. And since then, there has been a long evolution. I remember a time in which central banks would not even publish their models, their econometric models, because that was considered part of the the necessary element of secrecy in the conduct of policy. And things have changed a lot. I believe that now we live in a world of communication and transparency is more and more important. We are accountable towards a number of authorities and all. An evolution is in progress in all fields of public policy. And I think that the supervision cannot and should not escape that that process. Parsimony in data collection, in the information collection, in compliance burdens, the problem of duplication of authority. We are in a transitional phase, so to some extent it's necessary and actually useful that there is a temporary overlap of some elements of control, the legacy ones from the national authorities and moving into the European ones. This is unavoidable and I think healthy in many respects, but there has to be a limit to that and we are responsible for ensuring that there is efficiency there. The question, I think, raised by Roberto Gualtieri of the question of the hierarchy and the interaction between the different prudential precautions and prudential buffers, the macro and the micro, and the overlap that exists between them, and where the MDA is located. Now, all these things, I think, are very important. There is an effort to make these rules also consistent globally, not only in Europe, because of course European banks compete with global banks and there are different rules, etc. There is a dialogue there, but I think it's very important to progress toward more transparency and more comparability in a global context. Issues of overbanking, we know very well, we've dealt with that. Banks are going to live in a context of low growth for a while. And so business models have to adapt in order to make those banks sustainable in this different environment. All these things, I think, we have to keep very well in mind as part of the list of issues that we are collecting from this conference and that we need to reflect upon and work on. Having said that, I don't want to occupy more time of the rest of this panel. We have another 12 minutes or so before the coffee break. So I would like to ask first to the speakers whether they want to immediately intervene on one another or on of the issues that I've raised. And if not, I would be willing to get some questions from the audience. And I think I see Karel Lanou over there. If you can pass him a microphone, please. Karel Lanou, SEPS. Karel, please.
Thank you, and Injahnio, thank you for inviting us, and thank you for excellent introductions and panels. I mean, I would like to hint on one issue which I probably haven't heard enough. You referred to it, and also Mr. Dunkel, is the issue of overregulation and complexity of regulation in the sense that it creates a risk that bankers as well as supervisors are under so much pressure to do, to check so many different things, that we can't follow anymore. I mean, that the broader picture is missing. If I think, for example, at the CRD and CRR, which have 75 different ITS and RTS, meaning implementing technical standards, for those who do not know, and regulatory technical standards, which in principle have to be checked by the European Parliament. But there is such a burden of rules because of the single rule book that basically the only task which supervisors and bankers are doing is box ticking, and in the end, not really doing applying the proper judgment to supervise or to manage the risks which they are exposed to. Thank you.
Thank you, Karel.
Go ahead. I really couldn't agree more. From the real practical life, in the daily priorities of a CEO of a directly supervised bank, I really have to agree for it. We are catering for the wrong issues. And I'm not saying that we should not care for data, we should not care for quantities, we should not care for data sets for risk management. I'm all for that. I've learned a lot in that. But we are on the brink that the business models don't work anymore because the availability of focus of management is not there anymore. And I really have to support that point. I'm very grateful that you, from a supervisory point of view, I could not agree more, and it's starting to shape business model. This bank is selling businesses because we believe it's not worth the supervisory trouble to go through in private banking.
In the absence of...
It might be a good thing, by the way.
Thank you. In the absence of Commissioner Hill and Mario Nava, who unfortunately have left, I think I have to spend a word also in support of this legislation, because we apply it. So the problem that you mentioned is a problem for the banking sector, but it's also a problem for us. I have to say that the CRR, the regulation, is an extremely powerful and extremely effective instrument. I mean, we could not possibly have run the SSM without the CRR. With only directives, no way. So that works very well. It is also true that the CRR was written when the SSM was not even conceived. The norms with options and discretion, flexibility, national peculiarities, etc., was designed for a system in which there were different supervisory styles, different supervisory approaches. And so this makes it very, I agree with you, Karen, it makes it very, very complex to apply. There are reviews of this legislative piece, there is an evolution, you know, it's everybody's task to push in the direction of simplification and more effectiveness. And Matthias, please, on this.
Yes, thank you. Maybe just, I mean, of course, things are never simple enough. And there are a number of levels of complexity. First of all, there is the worldwide level. Basel is complex, and CRR is only, in a sense, the application of Basel to Europe. And clearly, there is an attempt in Basel to try and simplify things a bit. Then there is the SSM is a simplification process. Okay, there is in fact a startup phase, which may be complicated, but when you, Mr. Dunkel, said, well, you know, it looks like in Europe we want regional banks, well, the first beneficiaries, in a sense, of the SSM will be banks that have activities in a number of euro area member states, and there will be a streamlining. We need further streamlining, it's clear, and that maybe we are asking in the first phase indeed for too much information, and streamlining is necessary. But in a sense, there are also a number of forces towards simplification. On the other hand, it's also true that the crisis has uncovered quite a number of dimensions where there were a bunch of things that were not very nice that were happening and that we are trying at different levels to prevent. And of course, it brings more policing and more and these kind of things. But at some level, it's also endogenous to the various things that have happened.
Please, Roberto.
I substantially agree when one has to take into account first the complexity of Basel that was there. Second, the overlapping of direct deregulation, and the SSM is on top of that, in theory should be something which should reduce the complexity, not enhance, and it is partially doing. Of course, this coexists with the process that a bigger and more distant supervisors tends to have the need to be more based on quantitative element than the capacity of established qualitative dialogue. So we have a double dynamic. On the one hand, the dynamic of simplification. On the other hand, and hopefully temporary complication and more distant, more difficult the dialogue. So these are the two elements that I think should be distinguished and not confused. Then, of course, we will try to contribute to this simplification, streamlining, while, of course, keeping the prerogative of the Parliament in implementing the international standard, taking into account the specificity of the bank of the European society, economic models, and plurality of banking models, like we did in a number of elements, SMEs growing factor, CVA, when we transport Basel III. And of course, we will. I see here Sylvie Goulard, who is rapporteur on a delicate point of how the Europe can also speak with one voice and when it's international fora and can be more actively, proactively an actor and contributor to define global standard and implementing them, taking into account also European interests.
Okay, we have 3 minutes, so we can certainly fit another question if there is one. I cannot see. Yes, Stanislava Caprirolo from Slovenia.
Thank you. I have a question for Mr. Dunkel. While I am really very impressed by the feedback that you proceeded straightforward, very transparently, and I can subscribe to all your ideas behind these feedbacks for further improvement of SSM work, there is one issue that always struggles me a little bit. On one hand, there is true that there was a lot of changes in data requests coming from the regulatory supervisory framework. But on the other hand, being a banker, I mean, this is information that each bank should, and each decision maker in the banking system should have for his decision making process. So what is really the issue? You know, is it technical support? I mean, this should be in the banks available if you want to run a bank well. So.
Well, thank you very much for being able to clarify that. It's not that the bank, their data is not useful. Of course the data is very useful. The request is very simple. Tell us once what you want to know. Leave it alone for, I would say, 24, 36 months, and then make the next change. What is driving us crazy is the constant new invention of this is also useful to know. I don't deny the usefulness of any data. Nobody is inventing any crazy data sets. But for us, we have to implement it. So my request is not stay away from data because it's not useful. That's not my point. My point is we have to get our act together organizationally that you tell the banks, this is what we want to know for you, and that's it. It will be unchanged for the next 24 or 36 months. Then I build my systems, and after that, we then take the next step. What drives us crazy is really that everybody can invent data sets and push it on the banks, and we can't do our proper job serving clients.
This may be partly due also to the institutional complexity and different authorities in Europe, because as far as the SSM is concerned, we have set up a reporting system, and that's it, and you can build your systems based on that. But unfortunately, there are others. We have another minute. Anybody else who would like to? Yes, Martin. Helvig.
The SSM was created to dissolve the bank sovereign nexus. And President Draghi talked about the fact that it shouldn't make a difference as to which jurisdiction a bank is located in. Now, we've seen in the case of Greece that even after the Greek banks had gotten through the comprehensive assessment fairly easily, there was an issue about whether or not emergency liquidity assistance to Greek banks was justified in a situation where the problems came from the sovereign and presumably they're being subject to the political actions of the sovereign rather than from the banks. So the question is, does the Greek experience mean that we cannot get rid of this link at all?
I have an urgent request from Roberto Gualtieri.
I think that the result of the experience is positive. I think that the conditionality approach with which we solve the problem of, on the one hand, the no bailout, on the other hand, also the need to preserve the integrity of the Eurozone, so the fact that the stability assistance is linked to conditions, finally the condition prevails the will to apply the conditions. Of course, conditions can be changed relating to national democracy outcomes, but that's to be defined together at European level. So if you apply condition, you can have stability support and you can address on the side of the sovereign part of the problem. Then, of course, there is another part that you can, the trilemma that has been said cannot be fully solved if you don't have a fiscal backstop at EU level. So that's another missing part. There is not only the bridge financing, there is not only the deposit guarantee, but there is also the fiscal backstop that was part of the original agreement that we expect that will be start to be implemented. Not too late, because this is part of a global picture.
Last word to André Sapir.
Yes, I'm...
because we need to close,
I'm on Martin's side. And that's the reference I made to the lender of last resort. I think there needs to be lender of last resort for all the banks in the SSM, and it needs to be unconditional. It's unconditional. Okay. The only condition, obviously, is solvency. There's no other condition than solvency. And I think in this case, there was not an issue of solvency, there was an issue of liquidity. And I think, therefore, the lender of last resort should not have been an ELA, should have been provided by the ECB on an unconditional basis. That's a lender of last resort.
We have a word of last resort to Matthias de Vatripoli.
If I may, I don't want to start a debate, but I guess the current 10 to 25 billion... this is not a liquidity issue, it's a solvency issue. And therefore, it brings the question, indeed. I think Greece is a very interesting case, and we should think about it deeply. Because, by the way, the 10 to 25 billion that are needed is not, of course, because the state has defaulted. The state has not defaulted. It is because, indeed, lending to the local economy has got into trouble, very high NPAs and all that, because of trouble originating, the macro trouble originating, of course, with the Greek sovereign and all that. And so I do think that what we are witnessing is that our banking sector in a number of countries is extremely fragile, not because they misbehave, but because the economy is super fragile. And so we need better buffers, better automatic stabilizers in the system. I think Basel III is already better than Basel II. I don't think it's enough. And I think we should think hard about this, because otherwise, I mean, we cannot close the banking systems of countries that have big macro problems. That will not help. And of course, now a backstop, that's a nice word. By the way, everybody loves the word backstop, but it's synonymous to the word bailout that everybody hates. So I think we have to think about that. But I do think we would need, indeed, more automatic stabilizers in the banking sectors. And that would, of course, have to be prepaid by the banking sector and so on. But I do think there we have, it's not enough, the banking union is not enough, I think, to break the link.